Good morning, everyone. I'm very pleased to be in Morocco attending the World Policy Conference, which is my first time. I have two hopes. One is that my diary will allow me to come back to join you again next year. The second hope is that hopefully at next year's World Policy Conference, I'll be able to come with more of my fellow countrymen to share with you the Chinese narrative. I heard the name China being mentioned in many different contexts over the past day and a half, and I think I should encourage more of my fellow countrymen to come and share their narrative with you. Belt and Road, two basic points. One, the Belt and Road Initiative is not limited to the 60 plus countries that are found along the traditional Belt and Road. As an example, at the Belt and Road Summit held in Beijing May last year, the British Chancellor of Exchequer and the United States Secretary for Commerce also actively participated. Over 100 countries were in Beijing for that occasion. So that's the first point. Second, there are five connectivities. There are five connectivities. Much has been said about the successes and failures of the regional and international infrastructure projects, but there are actually five connectivities under the Belt and Road Initiative: policies, facilities, trade, capital, and people-to-people connectivity. So I repeat again: policies, facilities, trade, capital, and people-to-people. I shall return to these connectivities a bit later. The basic premise of the Belt and Road Initiative is that the world is highly connected, and although it is already highly connected, it can be better connected still through more focused international cooperation. We had, in the past, overlooked certain parts of the world in terms of connectivities. We have overlooked certain parts of connectivity, and we have overlooked certain ways of enhancing connectivity. So it's time in this increasingly globalizing world that we have sort of focused actions. Let me give you one example. Kazakhstan is a country. This country is not small. It's not on our lips every day. In terms of land mass, it is the 10th largest country in the world. I, for one, fly from Hong Kong and other parts of Asia to parts of Europe, typically London, very frequently. I sometimes even do Hong Kong-London day returns, leaving Hong Kong at midnight, arriving in London at 6 o'clock in the morning, breakfast, shower, change, going to the office by taxi, 9 o'clock meeting, finish at 5 o'clock, go back to the airport and fly back to Hong Kong. The flight, comfortable, convenient, takes about 11 hours. But somehow, we living in Asia and people living in London coming to Asia too, somehow assume that there's nothing. There's this hollowness between Hong Kong and Europe, or between Asia and Europe, not knowing that you have these large countries, including five-star countries, including Kazakhstan, the 10th largest country in the world in terms of landmass, that's there between Hong Kong and Europe. Flying from Hong Kong to Kazakhstan takes only about 5.5 hours. Flying from the closer parts of Europe to Kazakhstan, again, takes only about 5.5 hours. So that's one reason why we need to have a focused approach to connectivity, because we have been missing certain important parts of the world that we need to connect with. Now, why was I in Kazakhstan? I was there a few months ago to attend the launch of the International Financial Center. I had this conversation with the Kazakhstan Prime Minister when I was Chief Executive of Hong Kong three years ago, and he mentioned to me the fact that they have taken international advice and they want to establish an International Financial Center in Astana in Kazakhstan. And Hong Kong being one of the largest international financial centers in the world may have something to offer. And so finally, they were ready, they launched, was very well attended by European and American experts. There were a few Chinese people there. And it wasn't a Chinese initiative. It was an international initiative. And Kazakhstan has come up with a rather ingenious, innovative way of kickstarting their international financial activities. They have adopted, they needed to change the constitution for this. They adopted British common law when it comes to signing financial contracts. And they even appointed five senior British judges to form the Kazakhstan International Financial Center Legal Authority. Now, Kazakhstan is a landlocked country, big as it may be. There's now road connection to Xinjiang Autonomous Region of China. And then there's new rail connection from Xinjiang to a seaport in southern China. I had a conversation with the Deputy Prime Minister of Kazakhstan when I was there, exploring with him how goods to be exported from Kazakhstan to other parts of the world could use the road connection in China and then a new rail connection in China. Instead of going along the Yangtze River to an eastern seaport, they could actually go down as an alternative to go down to the southern part of China using a seaport there next to Vietnam. Now, who built the railway? It's a joint venture between Singapore and China. So that really goes to show how international something as simple, you may say, as moving goods produced in Kazakhstan to the outside world may be. Now, the Prime Minister of Cote d'Ivoire said yesterday that one of the priorities is the building of infrastructure. China is part of the international community, and China itself has done a lot of infrastructure in the past 40 years since reform started. And China realized a couple of things. Firstly, infrastructure projects could be costly. In Hong Kong, we just opened a month ago, a very expensive high-speed rail connecting Hong Kong to the rest of the country's high-speed rail network. A few days ago, we opened this longest sea bridge in the world, and also it's very costly. Now, China's learned that while these projects could be very costly, they are also crucially important in opening parts of the country so that people, goods, capital can move in and also in the reverse direction. And China likes to share this experience and expertise with other parts of the world. On the trade front, it's not just about China under the Belt and Road Initiative exporting more to other countries. It is also about China buying more from other countries as well. In about 10 days, the first China import expo will be opened in Shanghai. So far, 2,800 enterprises from 130 countries, including 180 from the US, have confirmed their participation. People-to-people connectivity, one of the five connectivities. Let me share with you what Hong Kong, as part of China, is doing as an example. I founded a year ago the Belt and Road Hong Kong Center. And this center focuses on people-to-people connectivity, not commerce, not trade, not capital movements. We've sponsored and organized so far students from 70 schools in Hong Kong to visit, shall I say, off the beaten track countries, including countries in Africa. The center will sponsor 280 school principals and teachers as well. We also have a cataract blindness eradication project going on in Cambodia, in a certain province in Cambodia. We have identified 8,000 to 10,000, which is the total size of the cataract blind population in this province in Cambodia. And our medical team is there to stay until the last patient is cured. So it will probably take about 2 years to do this. It's a rather unique project in that we don't fly in and fly out. We fly in, we stay there until the last surgery is performed. 2 weeks ago, the center sponsored a visit of about 14 orphans from Kazakhstan to Hong Kong. Lastly, let me just conclude by quoting this and saying this. Well, I'd like to quote this, no man is an island. What I'd like to say is no man should be an island. Thank you very much.